and freely talk about Jesus Christ. And let me tell you, the message of Jesus Christ ain't never changed. It ain't never going to change it as long as you're preaching the Bible. Now, there's a lot of different messages out there about Jesus, but I'll tell you what, I'm going to preach the one that's in here. The message of the Jesus in here is the message of the cross. The cross of Christ. And I'm going to tell you, you can never preach too much about the cross of Christ. If it weren't for that cross, I wouldn't be where I'm at today. If it was not for the cross of Christ, where would this world be? If it weren't for the cross of Christ, where would the church be? It wouldn't be no church without the cross. We wouldn't have anything without the cross of Jesus Christ. Now, I want to talk about that cross today. You know, I don't know if you know this or not, but the story of the cross, the complete story, is not recorded in any one gospel. When Jesus hung on that cross, he had seven sayings that he said. And there's not one gospel in itself that has all seven of those sayings in it. So you have to search through all four of the gospels to find these sayings of Jesus from the cross. And that's what I've done. I went through the gospels and put in order as best I could these seven sayings that Jesus said while he was hanging on that cross. And I believe that what you're going to find is that these seven sayings give us the complete gospel right there while he was hanging on the cross. It's the cross of Christ that means everything to me. If you ever hear somebody preaching anything else, any other way of salvation except the cross, you better hightail it out. There's only one way to find salvation. You've got to come to the cross. So if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke chapter 23 this morning. And I'm just going to read a couple verses to get started. It's not all here in Luke, but we're going to start right here. Luke chapter 23. Luke 23 and verse 32. And this is Luke's recollection of the crucifixion of Christ. Luke records how Jesus was there hanging on that cross. And we all know that he was not alone at that crucifixion. He was not crucified by himself. He was crucified among the criminals. Here was a man who had committed no sin, hanging there being punished with two criminals, two hardcore criminals. And that's where we find Jesus in Luke 23 and 32. It says, "And there were also two other malefactors." And a malefactor, that's a common criminal. That's what that is, a low-down criminal. And there were also two other malefactors led with him to be put to death. And when they were come to the place, which is called Calvary, there they crucified him. And the malefactors, one on the right hand and the other on the left. And then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Let's take some Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you for that cross. Oh, Lord, I know at the time it must have seemed like such a defeat when you hung on that cross and you gave your life for us, Lord. Little did the ones know who were there what a victory you had attained. Lord, I thank you for going to the cross for me. Lord, I thank you for taking the weight of my sin upon your shoulders. Lord, let us never forget what you've done on that cross, Lord. And let us be eager to tell everybody we come in contact with what the cross is all about. Lord, this morning I pray that you would send your Holy Spirit, Lord, in full power. And let the Holy Spirit come to us and soften our hearts. Make them receptive to the message that you're going to give us, Lord. And let the message be not my message, Lord, but let it be yours. I pray that you would just totally control me, Lord, and you would just speak through me, Lord, all the words that you would have said here this morning, Lord. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see and a heart to receive this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Yes, it's amazing. I can't imagine the spectacle on that day. And the Bible says that they led him to a place which is called Calvary. Old Calvary. Calvary is also called Golgotha, the place of the skulls, because it looked like a skull up on that mountain. He was up there on Calvary. Like I told you, saying, forgive them. It talks about forgiveness and fellowship at the same time. Oh, and through forgiveness, God makes sinners right with Him. You know, it's because of what happened in the garden that we have sinned and fall short of the glory of God because of Adam. But Jesus said, Father, forgive them. Who is them? That's what I ask myself. Who is them? But I'll tell you who them is. Them is us. Them is me. Them is you. Them is everybody that ever walked the face of this earth. He said, Father, forgive them because they know not what they do. Now, I'm going to tell you, when I was lost, I knew not what I was doing. I had no idea what a shipwreck of my life I was making. But I'm going to tell you, when that devil's leading you and guiding you, he will steer you down the wrong path. But Jesus said, even though you don't know what you're doing, I come here to die on this cross and save you. Yes, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. It all starts with forgiveness. Jesus Christ forgave me because I had hurt Him so much. And the Bible says when we sin, it hurts Jesus. It hurts God and God alone, nobody else. He is the one that we're hurting with our sins and our trespasses. But God made a way for all that to change. He made a way for us to have peace with God and forgiveness, but it only come one way, through that cross. Forgiveness and fellowship. You see, you can't have fellowship with Jesus unless you have forgiveness with Jesus. He's got to forgive you first for your sin. And Jesus came just for that reason. He came to forgive sinners. And it's through this forgiveness that sinners make God their Father. You know, everybody wants to be a child of God, but not everybody wants to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. We're all created by God, but we're not all children of God. The only people who are children of God are the ones who have accepted Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And I'll tell you one thing, I am a child of God. Hallelujah. Can you say that this morning? Can you say, I am a child of God because I have accepted Jesus Christ. I've been cleansed by the blood of the Lamb. Oh, that precious blood that ran down that hill at Calvary is the blood that cleanses an old sinner like me. Hallelujah for the cross. Oh, yes. If somebody asks you, how can I be saved? What can I do to go to heaven? Well, the first thing you got to do is get your sins forgiven. And let me tell you, you might say, I talked to this woman, I live at Smith Mountain Lake. I talked to a man yesterday. He said, yeah, Charlie, I can tell you the tales, but I can't tell you the names. I said, well, that's fine with me, brother. I got a lot of tales to tell to you, but I'll just leave the name out. I was up at Smith Mountain Lake, and we was working up there, and you know, here I am working and trying to tell people about Jesus. I didn't care. Anybody I work for, if you hired me, you was going to hear about the gospel. And this lady said, oh, yeah, I go to church. I go to church all the time. And I said, yeah, and I commenced to telling her about the gospel. She said, oh, you ain't got to tell me that. I'm not a sinner. I said, well, you ain't a sinner? She said, no, I go to church. I'm good. You need to take that mess and tell some sinner. I'm good. I'm not a sinner. You go home and tell somebody else that needs it. I don't need that mess. I said, you don't need it, and you're not a sinner. Then tell me how this can be. The Bible says we're all born in sin. There's none righteous, no, not one. How can you not be a sinner? How can you not need to hear the gospel? But so many people nowadays say, hey, Charlie, I've been saved. I don't need to hear about the cross. I don't need to hear about how Jesus died and He shed His blood for us. I don't need to hear about forgiveness of sin. Let me tell you, if you think you don't need to hear about it, you're the one that needs to hear about it. And that's what I told her. If you don't think you need to hear about sin, and if you don't think you're sinning, you're the biggest sinner of all. We're all sinners, and we all fall short of the glory of God, and we need to be reminded that sin has a penalty. And that penalty cost Jesus Christ His life. He died for me and He died for you because of my sins. You see, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. And when Jesus Christ shed His blood so my sins could be pardoned, so my sins could be forgiven, I thank God for that. Yes, Lord. And over in verse 43 is the next saying. He was hanging there, right there between those two thieves. And can you imagine? Here's two old common criminals hanging there with the Lord of glory. And they were just out there. And they deserved to be there. And that's what they said. In one of the Gospels, the criminal said, "You know what? We deserve to be here because we did these bad things. We committed these crimes." But Jesus didn't. He was hanging there for no crime. He committed no sin. Yet and still, he was hanging there. Oh, and we get mad when people talk bad about us for things we did do. Think about Jesus. He died for something he didn't do. But you know what? He was glad to do it. He was glad to die for me and to die for you. He was glad to give his life. He took it as an honor upon himself that he could give his life. Why? Because he loved his Father. And he was doing nothing but obeying his Father's will. He was submissive to the Father. He submitted to God's will. And God's will is that none should perish, but all should come to repentance. And that's what Jesus Christ was doing. In surrender to his Father, he died on that cross. Oh, yes. And right there in between those two thieves. But what did he say in verse 43? Let's get back a little bit. And 41 says, "And we're here justly, for we receive due reward of our deeds, but this man has done nothing." He's done nothing wrong. And he said unto Jesus, "Lord, remember me when thou comest in thy kingdom." That thief said, when you get where you're going, when you get your reward, when things calm down and you get straight, remember me, will you? And what did Jesus say? He said, "Well, I'll write it down. I'll make a note of it. When things settle down a little bit, I'll get back with you." Yeah. No, Jesus didn't say that. He said, "No, I'll tell you what. Not only will I think about you," he said, "but today, this day, you will be with me in paradise." When? What day? Day after tomorrow? Next week? You ever got to get in touch with a specialist? Anybody here ever had to get in touch with a specialist? Lord have mercy, you'll die waiting on a specialist. You can't even get in to see the doctor if you got the flu. And even worse, if you got man flu like Christian accuses me of. That stuff will kill you. You need to see the doctor quick with that. And they just blow you off, won't give you no medicine or nothing. You know, a specialist, you might have to wait a month. Depending on your insurance, you might have to wait a year. But this is Jesus. He said, "You ain't got to wait till tomorrow. I ain't got to make time." He said, "I created time. I'm above time." He said, "Today you will be with me." But where are you going to be? I'm sure that's probably what the thief was thinking. Well, where are we going to be at? I mean, I'm hanging on the cross. I'm thinking about it. I'm getting grading here a little bit. And where are you going to be? Jesus was probably thinking, "Yeah, I know what you're thinking, but I ain't going to be in no grave, not for long. I might be there for a little while, but they're going to come and find an empty tomb, because I'm going to be in heaven, you're going to be in heaven, and everybody that believes in my name is going to be in heaven." Amen. Yes, Lord, that's the them that we was talking about. All of them, that's me. I'm going to be in heaven one day because I've received Jesus. And where is it? He said it's going to be paradise there. We're going to be there today. A lot of people say, "Well, when you die, your soul goes to sleep, and then you'll wake up later on sometime." That ain't what Jesus told this man. He didn't say, "When you wake up in eternity, I'll be there." He said, "No, you're going to be with me today in paradise, in eternity, in heaven." There's no soul sleep. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And as soon as that thief's eyes closed and physical death took over, he was received into the arms of Jesus. He was awake. He was alive. Because let me tell you something. A lot of people may not understand this. But you know what? All souls are immortal. That's what the Bible tells us in a couple different verses in the Bible. All souls are created immortal. That means your soul will never die. Your physical body might, but your eternal soul will never die. It lasts forever. Ecclesiastes says when the clay pot is broken and the silver cord is loose, that the soul will return to God who gave it. See, when these old bodies wear out, when that silver cord breaks and this clay pot of a body returns to the dust, our soul is going to return to God, and we're going to have to give an account. And what is that account? It's either did you accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, or did you refuse Him? If you accepted Him, then your immortal soul will go to be with God in heaven. If you rejected Him, then your immortal soul will go to hell and be there in fire for eternity, in torment. That Jesus said the worm will not die. And it lasts forever. The burning never stops. It's a real place. And I know my wife gets real edgy when I start preaching about hell. But let me tell you what, Jesus preached more about hell than He preached about heaven. So I got to preach about hell. I got to tell you that hell is real because I don't want you to go there. I don't want nobody to go to hell. I want you to go to heaven. But let me tell you, if heaven is real, then that means hell's got to be real too. And it's real hot down there. You don't want to go there. And you ain't got to go there because Jesus Christ made a way. He said, if you receive me, you ain't got to wait till tomorrow. Today is the day of salvation. This day right here. If you don't know Jesus, this day can be the day when your name is written up in that Lamb's Book of Life. Oh, and you will receive your citizenship in heaven. Now, my citizenship is a little confused right now because Pennsylvania County thinks I'm still a citizen there because they sent me a tax bill yesterday. And they want me to pay for stuff that I ain't got no more, and I don't even live in that county no more because they're a little confused about my citizenship. And so I'm going to eventually have to call them and say, look, I'm no longer a citizen of Pennsylvania County. I'm now living in God's country up here in Essex County. So y'all are going to have to do without me because I had a change of citizenship. And let me tell you what, a whole lot of times the old devil gets confused with my citizenship too. And he comes and says, Charlie, you know, you used to be a citizen right here on my side of the world, but I have to remind him, no devil, my citizenship is in heaven now. I'm no longer a citizen of the world. I'm no longer a citizen in the country of slavery to sin. I'm free because the Son has set me free. I'm a citizen in the commonwealth of heaven, and nevermore will I return back. What did they tell Mephibosheth? You got to get out of Lodibar. God took me out of that place. He took me out of Lodibar, and I'm not going back because my citizenship is renewed, and it's in heaven right now. Why? Because just like He told the thief, this day you will be in paradise, and I praise God for that. Ain't gotta wait for it. It's right now. It's today. It's immediate. Sad thing is, though, not everybody will be in paradise because not everybody's going to repent. Not everybody's going to accept Jesus Christ. But it's not because He didn't make a way for that to happen. He made a way. And then the next saying of the cross comes from John. From John 19 and 26, he looks down at his mama and he says, he looks down at his mama and he says, woman, behold thy son. And then he said, son, behold thy mother. What was he doing? Well, that lets me know that family was important to Jesus. You know, He was the God of heaven and earth. He sat at the right hand of God from all eternity past. But when He come down to earth, He come down and He was born a little bitty baby. And He had a mom. And guess what? Jesus loved His mom. The God of the universe, the Lord of all creation. And He loved His mom. I'm telling you, children, you better love your mom. I'm telling you, grown children, you better love your mom. I'm telling you, young children, you better love your mom. You better respect your mom. You better care for your mama, because you ain't got but one, and your mama ain't going to be here forever. And when she's gone, every time that you've ever disrespected your mama, it's going to come back and haunt you. You know that? You're going to wake up from nightmares at night about them times you disrespected your mama. You're going to wake up in a cold sweat on account of the times you was ugly to her. And you're going to pray to God that you can take it all back. But you know what? You can't take it. You ain't got but one that your days may be long. So I'm just telling you, and how do I know all this stuff? The Bible tells me, and I've been the man that woke up from these dreams, wanting to take it back. Those things that I did to my mom, those things that were not right. And let me tell you, I smacked my mom, none of that stuff. And I never cussed my mom out like people do today. You know, I ain't never spoke a cuss word to my mom all her life. I never drew my hand back to my mom. I never did all that stuff. But I still hurt because I did some things that disappointed my mama. And I disrespected my mama sometimes. And I can't take it back. And y'all can laugh what you want to. But I'm going to tell you, one of these days you're going to remember the words coming out of my mouth. All of you going to remember them words. Because I remember them. I've been there. And I'm telling you, don't do it. Family is important. It's the most important thing except for Jesus there is in this world, is your family. That's all you got except for Jesus is your family. And you know what? A church family is the same way. We got to love on each other just like we would love on our blood kin. Because we're all kin under the blood of Jesus. Jesus loved his mom. I can't do nothing about the things I wish I could take back, but I can tell y'all not to do them. And the ones of y'all that still got your mama, y'all ought to turn around right now and say, Mama, I love you. Because I'm going to tell you, she loves you. Mama's love is a kind of love that's different from anything else except for Jesus' love. My mama... My mama and Jesus, about the only two that can love me unconditionally. Christy does a good job, but I know it's hard. And that's the difference. That's the difference. It's hard for Christy, and it's hard for wives to love their husbands, but it ain't hard for a mama to love their children. That's easy, because that same kind of love Jesus has. It's an unconditional love. Mama's love unconditionally, no strings attached. And you know what? My mama loved me even though I mistreated her. My mama loved me even though I broke the rules. My mama loved me just as good as if I'd have been the best kid in the world. That's how much she loved me. And you know what? Jesus loves you just the same. Don't matter how many rules you break. Don't matter how many sins you commit. Don't matter how bad you've been to your mama. Jesus still loves you and he still forgives you. And you can find that forgiveness at only one place. It's the cross. And it's there that we take it to the cross. Jesus Christ forgives us. He said, Son, behold thy mother. Mother, behold thy son. You see, John was a good boy. And John was going to take care of Jesus' mother. And it was that new family relationship. Well, you know what? When we get adopted into the family of Christ, God becomes our dad. He becomes our father in heaven. And we get adopted into that family just like what Jesus said. And then when you find a good Bible-believing church that God is leading you to become a part of, then that's when that church is your family. That's when that church is just like your blood relatives. That's when you go to that church and it's no longer a church, but it's your family. That's the kind of God we serve, a family God, a God of relationships. Yes. Though he put his father's work and purpose first, Jesus didn't neglect his mama either. Yes, Lord. And the fourth and fifth words, I'm about to lose my voice, I believe. The fourth and fifth sayings of Jesus, it turns dark. Because the Bible says that it was the whole world went into darkness. He was up on that cross at the end. Jesus said in Matthew 27:46, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? And you know, this is the only verse in the Bible where Jesus calls God, God, instead of my Father. Why is that? Because at that moment in time, God had to turn his back on his one and only Son. Why? Because at that moment in time, every sin that was ever committed in the world was put on the way of Jesus. Jesus became sin. And when Jesus became sin, God could no longer have fellowship with Jesus. God had to turn his back on his one and only son. Why? Because of me. Because of my sins. Because of my transgressions. God had to turn his back. And Jesus felt it. My God, why have you forsaken me? Oh, and I know so many times we probably ask the same thing because we feel like God's so far away and we don't get our prayers answered or he's not touching our hearts like we think he ought to. And we say, God, why have you left me? Why have you forsaken me? But you know what? Thanks to Jesus, he will never forsake us. Even though he had to forsake his one and only son, it's because of that that God will never leave us. He'll never forsake us. Because he did, he turned his back on Jesus. Jesus became sin. When he knew no sin, he turned his back on him. My God, why have you forsaken me? But Jesus knew why. Jesus had to take the punishment of our sin. If it was going to work, if this plan was going to come together, Jesus had to take the punishment. Now, what is the ultimate punishment for sin? It's separation. You want to know what hell is? You want me to define hell for you very articulately? Well, let me tell you what it is. It's being separated from God and his people. And I believe in hell because this is what the Bible says. That I know the rich man seen from afar off paradise, but he couldn't get there. Oh, he wanted to get there. He saw paradise and he said, look, if you'll just let Lazarus bring me a drop of water and let it drip down on my tongue. What did Abraham say? Abraham said, well, you know, we would, but there's this big gulf between me and you. And I imagine that gulf is probably filled with fire. And he said, I can't go over there and you can't come over here. I believe hell is eternal separation from God, but I believe you'll know who you are. I believe you'll know every time you went to church and they said, all who will receive Jesus, come on down this aisle and profess the name of Jesus. I believe you remember every time that preacher knocked on your door and tried to get you to accept Jesus, tried to get you to come to church. I believe you'll remember every time you forsook God. I believe you remember every time you rejected the gospel when you're in hell, because you'll be conscious. And you'll be conscious how long? Forever. Forever. Oh, it's not a place you want to be. But you know what? Jesus went there. Jesus went there for us. He went there so he could take that punishment for us so that we don't have to. I can see right now this is becoming a two-part sermon here because I am halfway through. And we're going to go through all of this. And so I just want to conclude by saying this. God said he'll never leave us. He'll never forsake us. But you know what? The first thing you got to do is get in fellowship with Jesus. Oh, you got to be in fellowship with him. What does fellowship mean? Well, the Bible says, how can two walk together unless they're like-minded? You can't walk with Jesus unless you're like-minded. You can't have fellowship with Jesus unless you think like Jesus, unless you agree with what the Bible says. Do you agree with what the Bible says, church? Do you believe what the Bible says? Even though you don't understand all of it, do you still believe it? Do you believe all of it? Do you believe it's truly God's word that he led human people? That's because that's what people tell me. Well, if humans wrote it, it could have mistakes in it. But you know what? The Bible's never been proven wrong. Even though human beings wrote it, the Holy Ghost kept those writers from making an error. The Bible's never been proven wrong. Not one thing in the Bible has ever been proven wrong. And it all starts with God's word, with the Bible. Do you believe it? Because if you believe it, then it says, if you believe with your heart and confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. Amen. And you'll be in fellowship with him. It also says that if we say we have not sinned, that we're a liar and the truth is not in us. And then in 1 John chapter 1, he goes on to say that if we have sinned, we need to ask God to forgive us. And not only is he faithful I want to be in fellowship with you. I want to be like-minded with God. I want to be like-minded with my fellow church members, because otherwise, how can two walk together unless they're like-minded? I want to be like-minded with Jesus. I want to be like-minded with my brothers and sisters in Christ. Because if we have that, then we can honestly have the promise that Jesus will never leave us and never forsake us. Do you have that promise this morning, children of God?
Amen.
I've got it. Praise God. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you for that cross. We thank you for Calvary. Lord, may preachers all across this world never forget to preach the cross, Lord. There's no way to get to heaven without a cross. Lord, there's no way to be forgiven of our sins without having a cross to take our sins to. Lord, there's no way that there can be any atonement for our sins unless Jesus was on that cross. And Lord, I thank you for the cross, but Lord, I thank you even more for that empty tomb, Lord. And I thank you that Jesus Christ overcome death, hell, and the grave, and he now sits at the right hand of God, ever interceding on our behalf. I just thank you for all these things, Lord. I pray again. I pray two things, Lord. Number one, if there's anybody here within the sound of my voice that doesn't know Jesus, that they would come surrender to him this morning. Number two, if there's anybody who is not walking together with you, Father God, that they would